So up till now, we have covered the analysis portion of the struts, that was our angle sections. Our total module is divided into two parts, that is struts and columns. And in struts and columns both, there are two bifurcations again. The first one is analysis and the second one is design. We have completed our first part, that was analysis of struts. Now we'll be moving towards our second portion, that is design of struts. Clear? So in moving forward, the question here is, design a single angle discontinuous strut to carry a factored load of 65 kN. Assume that the distance between its joint is 2.5 meter. That means the central standard distance has been prescribed as 2.5 meter. Take Fy equal to 250 megapascal. It's been given in the question. Clear? So in design problems, generally the load is been asked and we need to find the section that it will carry the load. Clear? So in this case, as it is given, we need to design a single discontinuous strut. That means we need to design an angle section that is of ISA grade. You can either opt for equal sections or you can opt for unequal sections, but we will always opt for equal sections if it is not provided in our question. Clear? So we'll be always opting for equal sections. So the leg dimensions will be same and it will be easy in solving the problem, as we can see here now. So here the first, that is load, is been given. It is given as to carry a factored load of 65 kN. So as it is the factored load, we will be not multiplying it by 1.5. And as you can see here, that the next step will be to find the effective length, that is the KL ratio. Okay? So effective length here, as it is the center length, is given as 2500 mm. Here the supports are not mentioned, whether it is hinged or something like that. So we'll be just assuming it to be the total length. We will be assuming just k equal to 1 in every case. In every case, while starting the design, we'll be always assuming k to be 1. So assuming k to be 1, our effective length comes out to be 2500 mm. Now regarding struts, strut can be asked in two parts, that is a single angle struts or double angle struts. In both parts, the design procedure will be the same that will be seen. There is just one minor change in that, and that is the assumption. Every design problem starts with an assumption, whether it may be of RCC structure or steel structures. Clear? So while designing, we always need to assume certain data. So for, again, keep in mind, it is not being prescribed in our IS code, so you need to remember this. For always a single angle strut, that means for always designing a single angle strut, we will be always assuming the slenderness ratio, that is KL by R, to be 120. And if the question is for a double angle, we will be always assuming our KL by R to be 100. You need to remember these two things, that if the single angle is being asked, we always will be assuming the slenderness ratio to be 120. And if the question is asked for double angle struts, then the only change will be the this thing, that is our slenderness ratio. So slenderness ratio will be assumed to be 100. Clear? Now we won't be finding our values, that is we won't be finding our values of, you can say, lambda, phi, etc., that we solve in analysis purpose. We will be directly using our table that has been prescribed in the IS code to find the proper section. After finding the proper section, or you can say that trial section. Why it is called trial section? Because we will be doing analysis on that part to prove that the section that we have selected actually resists this amount of load, that is 65 kN load, or not. Clear? So it is termed as a trial section. So our ultimate aim will be to find that trial section, and we need to do analysis on that trial section, and then we'll be finally proving that the section that we have assumed is able to resist the amount of load that has been prescribed in our question. This will be our sum pertaining to design, whether it will be of a single angle or a double angle. The steps will be the same, only the first change that will be the slenderness ratio, that is KL by R. Clear? So here we need to assume a trial section, and for that you need to go to this page, that is page 42 of your IS code. Again, page 42 of your IS code. There you can see table 9C is being prescribed. This table can be used only for design purposes. For analysis of struts, this table won't be used. So don't use this table for that purpose, because it is just a one-liner answer from this page. So for analysis purpose, it will be of 7-marker question. So we always need to follow the steps, that is to find lambda, 5, FCC, etc., or lambda eccentricity if it is a concentric or eccentric loading respectively. Clear? So here, while designing, we'll always be using this table 9C, that is for design compressive stress, that is FCD, for a column having buckling class C. As we have discussed in earlier sessions too, that angle will always follow the buckling class C. Yeah? It is given in our IS code that we have seen earlier. So for buckling class C, we will always using this table, that is table 9C. Here you can see that in the first column, the column is mentioned of the ratio KL by R. So we have assumed slanderous ratio to be 120 mm. And in the first row, you can see the yield stress has been mentioned. So the yield stress in the question given is Fi, that is 250. So we'll be following this column and we'll be following this row, that is for our KL by R equal to 120. So the intersection point that comes out to be 83.7. So in our case, the FCD will be taking as 83.7 Newton per mm square. This is based on the assumption. We'll be finding our final answer later on. This is just our assumption purpose, clear? So the FCD that we'll be assuming is 83.7 Newton per mm square. Now we need to find the area, that is the required area to sustain the amount of load. The amount of load to be sustained is given in the question as 65 kilonewton. So to resist this amount of load, we need to find the area that will be required for our strut, or you can say angle section. So it is just a basic simple equation, that is of stress. Sigma equal to P by A. As you all know, the stress equal to load upon area. If we make area as our subject, our equation becomes this, that is area equal to load upon stress, clear? Load, that is the total load to be resisted, and stress, that is our FCD value, clear? So in this case, the area required comes out to be 777, that is 777 mm square. So now we need to select an angle section whose area or cross-sectional area is greater than 777, clear? So this will be taking from your skill table. So now the main purpose or the main function of our sum is to know how to use the skill table, clear? But now keep in mind, this is a design problem and we need to identify the sections. In the previous examples, the section was already given and we were proving our section classification, that whether AE equal to AG actually follows it or not. We have seen both the cases, that whether it is a sufficient section or it is a not sufficient or insufficient section, clear? So here while designing, we won't be opting for an inefficient section. We'll be always assuming that our section is perfectly valid. That is, AE equal to AG is valid. And to follow this case, that is to satisfy this cases, we always must check these cases in our rough page. Again, this is not to be mentioned in your question or in your answer paper while writing your examination. This thing is to be done in the rough section because it is to identify the section that you will be taking. If you choose a random section whose area is greater than 777 and while proving the section classification or the check for slenderness ratio, if the section fails, then you need to rewrite the whole sum again. Clear? So for time efficiency and for saving your marks, we always will be doing this thing in a rough section, that we will be proving these cases in prior, that whether the section classification will be valid or not, we'll be checking it prior, and if it is valid, then and then only we'll be using that section, clear? So this step will help us get our perfect answer. Also, it will be helping us in reducing our time that we'll be taking if the check fails, clear? So in this case, if the checks are predetermined or predefined, then it won't be failing in the next steps, clear? So this thing has to be noted, that we need to check this thing, that is the B by T ratio, the D by T ratio, and the B plus D by T ratio. Also, the KL by R, that is our maximum slenderness ratio. It is always to be done when our design is asked. If it is, the question is asked for analysis, this step is not to be done. But if the question is for design, we always need to check whether the slenderness ratio is equal to or it is less than the maximum capacity it can attain as per our IS code. Clear? So these things we'll be checking in our rough page. And here I have selected a section that is 75 cross 75 cross 6. From the steel table page number 4, you can select any of the section that has been prescribed in your steel table. But before finalizing any section, you always need to check these two things in prior, in rough, to valid or to prove that our section will be actually satisfying or not. So the section that I have classified is 75 cross 75 cross 6, and from steel table you can see here from page number 4, the sectional area of it is 866 mm square here, and from page number 5 we can get the value of R minimum, that is minimum radius of gyration. So the minimum radius of gyration comes out to be here, 1.46 centimeter, that is 14.6 centimeter, clear? So now we'll be doing the actual checks that we have already done, but now we'll be proving it. The first will be the KL by R ratio. The KL by R ratio, that is a slenderness ratio. Here, K is will be always assuming it to be 1. Here, if it's not asked in the question, we'll be always assuming it to be 1. That is, we'll be assuming both ends are hinged. So KL will be 2500 divided by R. R, that is our radius of gyration as per our section. So as per our section, the radius of gyration comes out to be 14.6. So substituting here, the value should be always less than 180. Why so? Because moving on to page number 20, this is something new. So pause this video and move on to page number 20. On page number 20, you can see this table, that is table number 3 being mentioned. It is for maximum values of effective slenderness ratio. And in the first case, you can see that a member carrying compressive load, our struts always carry compressive loads, resulting from dead loads and imposed load, the maximum effective slenderness ratio, that is KL by R, should be 180. Means the effective slenderness ratio should not exceed 120. So the final answer should be less than or equal to 180. So as per our IS code, this statement is always need to be checked. If it fails, then the section that you have selected, that is a trial section, will not be valid and you need to select another section for it, clear? So for time saving, we'll be always checking these two things and then we'll be solving our steps that we have seen, clear? So this was our first check. The second check will be to identify our states, that is our section classification. So to identify the section classification, again we will be referring the same things, that we will be referring are this clause, that is mentioned for single angle or double angle, and there are three cases being mentioned. The first case is of V by T, the second is of D by T, and the third will be of B plus D by T. These things will be always doing priorly in a rough, clear? This is just how to write in an examination afterwards, clear? So before selecting the section that we have selected 75 cross 75 cross 6, this step always you need to do priorly. So here the answer comes out to be 12.5 or 25. All the three things should always be satisfied because it will be beneficial in time saving and also will be proving directly that AG equal to AE. So as the three cases are satisfied, we can write that AE will be equal to 866 mm square, clear? So this was our section classification. Now we'll be moving on to our actual sum. Our actual sum is based on two things. The first thing is that the load can be either acting as a concentrically loaded, or the load can be acting as a loaded through one leg, or you can say eccentrically loaded. While designing, if it is not mentioned in most of the cases, that in 90% of the cases it would be mentioned in the question that what section we need to take. So we will be always taking while designing that the load is acting eccentrically, because in practical scenarios concentric loading is not possible because the load will always act either on the leg, clear? On either leg, either it will be acting on a shorter leg or the load will be acting on the longer leg. The load cannot be acting outside of the section, clear? On the, or the outside perimeter of the section. The load must be passing through the section or the body itself, clear? Assuming that the load is acting eccentrically or the load is acting through one leg, that is either it may be a shorter leg or longer leg. So for eccentric loading, we always need to find the value of lambda e, and for that we need to find these cases. So these cases can be obtained from the page, that is our page 48. So if the bolts are not given, in design purposes mostly the bolts will not be given, so if the section or if the bolts are not being given, then we will always be assuming that there are two numbers of bolt being used and it they are both at fixed condition, clear? So while designing purposes or while designing our section, we will be always assuming two number of bolts with fixed condition. So as you can see from table, this is for greater than or equal to 2 and this condition is for fixed condition. So from this we can say that K1 is equal to 0.2, K2 is equal to 0.35 and K3 is equal to 20. So the values of K1, K2 and K3 can be obtained here on. You can either opt for any, but for check purpose perspective that it won't be failing. We always will be assuming the first case, that is two number of bolts and fixed condition, clear? So now we'll be finding the value of lambda VV and lambda phi that can be obtained from again page number 48. These equations can be obtained from page number 48. As you can see, lambda VV again, this term that is pi square epsilon is wrongly printed in our IS code, so it is actually pi square e, that is Young's modulus or modulus of elasticity. So solving it, we get lambda VV equal to 1.926 and lambda phi equal to 0.1406. So substituting everything in the term, that is lambda e, we get the value of lambda e to be 1.376. So this is how we will be calculating lambda e in the problem, that is design of struts, whether it will be of a single angle strut or a double angle strut. And the next thing will be to identify these cases, that is the lambda value is completed. Now we'll be moving on to the phi portion, then we'll be solving FCD, and lastly we'll be proving that the p that we are getting after plotting or after keeping this section to be 75 75 cross 6 is greater than 65, that is to be resisted. Clear? So this is our ultimate goal. So now we'll be finding the value of phi, and for phi we'll be needing alpha. Alpha always depends on buckling class. For angle section, the buckling class will always be your c that we have seen earlier too, and the value of alpha comes out to be 0.49. So solving everything, we get phi equal to 1.735, and substituting the value of phi in the term FCD, we get the value of FCD to be 81.36 Newton per mm square. The previous case that in the first slide we saw was the FCD obtained from the table, that is 9C, but it was based on the assumption that we have assumed the slenderness ratio. This is actually as per our section provided, clear? So both are different things. This is our final FCD and that was our assumed FCD, clear? So after finding this FCD, we will be finding the load. So the load that it can carry is 70.46. Means the section that we have provided, 75 cross 6, can carry a load of 70.46 kN, which is greater than the required load, that was 65 kN. So 75 cross 6 can be opted as a truss. Clear? So for getting this answer correctly and not failing in the final step, those prerequisites that I have taught earlier should be solved by you in rough section priorly before starting the sum. Clear? So it will be helpful to you in finding the proper and correct section from page number either 4 or 6 of your steel table. Clear? So this was our sum pertaining to design of struts, whether it will be of a single angle strut or double angle strut. The only thing that will be changing is the KL by R ratio. For double angle, the KL by R ratio will be taken as 100, and there is, and dependent on that, the other parameters will be changed, and the analysis will be done same in the same process that we have seen earlier too. Clear? So this is our today's exercise problem. Solve it, and from the next session onwards we'll be starting with our column portion. Thank you.